Well, good morning, my friends. What a privilege it is to sit here and be facing you. Anybody here for the first time today? Oh, quite a few. Great. Well, you've come on a sort of unusual day in that I'm thinking of it as more of a love party than a traditional meditation morning. And I got a little support in it. There's a company that monitors one's online reviews, and someone put this on Yelp in January. This is a safe place for me to learn about simple ways to improve my mental health. I'm not a Buddhist, but I don't mind their teachings, even though I have more of a Christian background. Robert is an eccentric Portlander. I like that. I'm going to put that on my resume. Some people don't understand him because he's silly and doesn't act spiritual. He also tries to stay current with latest technology without being caught up in it. This community is refreshing to be around, and I've gotten some useful tools for my wellness over the last year of visiting every now and then, plus watching the online streaming broadcasts on Ustream. Thanks, PIMC. You guys rock. Now, that's better than the review that said I was checking my email on the... I wasn't. Back a little, not so long ago, I was doing the broadcast from here, and now we have, thank you, Liberty up there doing it with much higher resolution and skillfulness. So, Jennifer, my wife, made a mixtape for me for Christmas. And I was listening to it on the way over, and there was a song that I thought is the perfect song to start with this morning. Kate shudders. It's... You may remember it. D-H-I-N-K.
Something that keeps knocking at my brain. Before I go insane, I hold my pillow to my head and spring up in my bed, screaming out the words I dread. I think I love you.
I think I love you.
This morning I woke up with this feeling I didn't know how to deal with, and so I just decided to myself I'd hide it to myself and never talk about it, and did not go and shout it when you walked into the room. I think I love you. I think I love you. So what am I so afraid of? I'm afraid that I'm not sure of a love there is no cure for. I think I love you. Isn't that what life is made of? Though it worries me that I never felt this way.
I don't know what I'm up against. I don't know what it's all about. I got so much to think about.
Better still, I'd better stay around and love you. Do you
I have a case. Let me ask you to your face. Do you think you love me? I think I love you. I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
I think I love you.
Well, that's the Dharma talk for today. A poem, a very short poem from Hafiz, 900-year-old poem. The subject today is love, and for tomorrow as well. As a matter of fact, I know of no better topic for us to discuss until we all die. One of the most influential teachers in my life, a man called Achan Sumedho, the eldest Western Thai forest monk, said one time in a Dharma talk, love means there is room for everything. So we're about to sit silently for a while. We could undertake spiritual practices that have to do with exclusion and trying to get rid of things. Or we could practice what I think of as satipatthana vipassana, which includes everything. We cultivate those remarkable, life-transforming mental capacities of mindfulness and concentration, curiosity, investigation, joy, tranquility, equanimity, the enlightenment factors. We create those conditions, and they bring illumination into that which sits here, that which is a human being that thinks of itself as separate, and also into all the processes that are our linkage with the entire universe. So, philosophical words, where the rubber meets the road is this moment right here, your body touching the cushion or the chair or the floor. Contact. This body is remarkably, miraculously alive. It won't be forever. It started with birth or started with conception. And until that last breathing out, there will be life. And a certain continuum of consciousness. The Buddha's extraordinary discovery, I think arguably the most important discovery ever made, the discovery was that it's possible volitionally, intentionally, to engage ourselves in that consciousness and to cultivate it, and to cultivate it to such a degree that we realize our true nature, we realize what we really are, not just this little creature that took birth. And then we realize that, not that we get it from a book and then dogmatically try to convert others to assuage our uncertainty, but that it becomes real for us such that we can actually relax in our lives and we can open to love. So where is the life most predominant in your body right now? Hands, face, back. It shows itself as pleasant sensations and unpleasant sensations, and lots of rather neutral sensations. And one way to work to stabilize the mind is to use a primary object, a chosen direction, sort of. And the breath, the sensations of breathing, provide a marvelous handrail like that. And so we can quite remarkably bring awareness together with the very beginning of a breath, the rising to fullness of the chest and abdomen, the decline, the vanishing. We quickly discover that it's not so simple. The I that decides to stay with the breath lasts about that long. And then the conditioning of the mind comes in, and there are thoughts and emotions and memories and plans, the past and future. And it's as though we fall into trance states. Some of these are pretty painful. Worry, remorse, anxiety, depression, fear. When we sit still like this, we stand a chance of noticing those trances. Awareness awakens and notices the mind in them or wandering. And then there's returning to the breath. That moment of awakening when the mind is wandering, is the quintessential essence of the awakened mind. And so we practice these conditioning strategies. Come home to the breath when you can. Notice when the mind wakes up. Return to the breath absolutely gently. Again, it was Achan Sumedho who said that he didn't teach loving kindness or metta practice aside, separate from insight practice. He said rather, bring love, bring metta to everything. So the most virulent wandering mind, the most nasty self-criticism, the most awful physical or emotional pain, let there be room for it. Also, let there be room for bliss and delight and joy and happiness and contentment, concentration. Come home to this living moment, which is the only moment that exists. Are you doing battle with anything in the mind? Is there something you're trying to get rid of? It won't work. War in the outer world is a disaster. War in the inner life is just as bad. How can we get rid of something that's part of us? Rather than trying to get rid of part and purify some other little part, why not expand? Why not accept? Why not acknowledge and relax? Bringing awareness whenever you can, gently, gently, into the actual sensations of this body breathing in and breathing out. If emotions come, embrace the emotions. If body pain comes, go into it, explore it, accept it. Bring love to it. When we sit still, eventually discomfort arises. As living beings, as mammals, we're habituated to move to avoid pain. Very useful, essential capacity. But in meditation, we practice sometimes pushing the edge of the envelope, meaning tolerate, turn toward, embrace, inhabit that which is unpleasant. And we don't do that for masochistic reasons. We do it so that we can study the experience of discomfort and suffering and use that to illuminate in a bite-sized way what causes the suffering. And the Buddha taught that the pain itself is not suffering. It's the resistance. It's the unenforceable rule that I shouldn't have pain. Sounds. We don't need a silent place to meditate. One place I practiced in Rangoon in Burma was on one of the busiest streets in the city. Traffic, people selling things, sirens. Sounds come and go just like the breath, just like thoughts, just like moods. Everything sings to us constantly of interconnection and transience. And in the middle of it, there's this coming and going of the breath, the thoughts. There's this sitting here solidly aware of the body. Thank you. Thank you. the mystery of awareness observes body sensations, the feeling tone of perceptions, body sensations, pleasant, unpleasant, indeterminate. Awareness observes all the various stories and perceptions and memories and fantasies of past and future. Awareness notices the five hindrances and the enlightenment factors and more. With loving presence, it becomes more and more obvious that none of these aspects of being human are stable. They are beyond radically impermanent. They are the essence of impermanence. And even that which is aware of these phenomena is equally impermanent. It comes and goes. To abide in this truth is to love. There's room for everything. There's ease. It's a rather raucous presidential primary season. Let's check out the raucous level in here. Who experienced great peace and ease? How about restlessness, agitation? Look around, see. How about disliking? How about liking? How about sloth and torpor, dullness? How about happiness? How about open-heartedness? How about sadness? How about despair? A little bit. How about great faith? It's a busy place, isn't it? Busy place. Isn't it remarkable how these states come and go? What I'm marveling in most in my own practice of late is the mystery. It's been happening for a long time, but it's getting clearer and clearer. The mind will wander off and go blah, 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 blah. And then out of nowhere, boink. Presence, awareness. I have no idea where that comes from. Thoughts, self-limit. There's this, they self-awaken. How odd. Well, Mr. Jim, would you like to dance with the group a little bit? Well, someone suggested I say this. At the end of Jim's movement, we go on for another hour. There's a Dharma talk, and then there's goodies in the kitchen. And this would be a worthy morning to stay for, because it's going to have a lot of love in it. All right, sir, here's your...
So we get in touch again with our standing form, and there's a little bit of that song still going in my head from the beginning. So as we sink and breathe out and breathe in, we can look at our hands. I think I love you. Feel the legs rising. I think I love you too. And then we get introduced to the rib cage opening. Gratitude, appreciation. It still works. Okay, we'll reach overhead and paint a rainbow. And release the arms, cross the wrists and rise, separate the clouds. And turn to the side, open the palms towards the heavens, and then bring one hand in and push with the other. Now bringing both hands back, shoulders open to the back and overhead and then down. And if you need to adjust any of these moves, go ahead. No, there's no bonuses for pain. lift the cross. One heel comes off the floor, the other foot is anchored. Then we turn and gaze at the moon. Pressing across. Reach up and we'll start cloud hands. One hand towards the earth, one hand looking at us. We go across, switch. The upper hand is like a cloud with a shadow following on the earth below. With the shoulders soft, the elbows soft, the hands are open and soft like a cloud. The lower hand just glides. Sometimes being in touch with the earth is easy. And other times we make a big production out of it. Let's splash in the sea. Ride the waves. Open the arms. And turn to the other side. I've never danced with so many roses. Riding the waves. And opening the arms. Okay, come back to the center. Find your feet under the shoulders and sink into the knees. Make a fist. Let the dragon rise from the sea. And up on the toes. Soar with the cranes. Turn the wheel. We'll change direction. And back to the center, equalizing the weight. Lift one hand and one leg on opposite sides. And then the centering breath. Just gathering energy from all sides. Then we come to stillness, the other part of Qigong. Just becoming aware of the activity within the body rather than the external postures and poses. Scanning through what's alive. There may still be areas that are stagnant and dull. Can we breathe into those? Use some of the other energy to vitalize the whole standing form. So this river of sensation is flowing all through the day. Whenever we pause and remember, you make contact with this easy flow. It follows the breath, follows simple gestures, follows all of our interactions with other people. It's accessible whenever we move. So let's bend the elbows, bring our hands together, feel the contact and gratitude, and bow to our brothers and sisters. Thank you for being here. Take care.
Thank you, Jim. Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you all on this Valentine's Day. Look at these flowers, aren't they something? My name's Kate. If you've never been here before, I support the community, and if you ever need anything, please find my information on our website, portlandinsight.org, and call and leave me a message if I'm not here, or I work about 20 hours during the week, so you'll find me or not, but I'll call you back if you leave me a message. We have so much information at portlandinsight.org, including all of the information about our upcoming classes. We have two. One is a more advanced class. It's called Awake, and you will find that on the website. And both that and another one, the Four Foundations of Mindfulness, start in March, and they will be 10-month classes. If you're not familiar with the way we do things here, we do offer these classes are by no donation. There's a suggested donation. If you can't afford it, please let me know. We don't want anyone to not study, to not take the classes because of finances. So don't let that stop you. It's really, really important, and it's one of the best things that we do here. If you're not on our lists, if you don't know about our classes and you want to be notified proactively rather than going to the website, there is a list at the back of the room. It's a blue list, and you can sign up either for the listserv, which is where the community speaks to one another. It can be a little chatty, and if you don't like getting a fair amount of email, you might want to just join the email list where you'll just get announcements. This collection box goes to people who are cold and wet and who don't have the resources that we have. And so Michael Mitchell, where are you, Michael? There. Michael takes this stuff and takes it to transition projects, right, Michael? And it helps lots and lots of people. So the winter is not over. Please do continue to bring things. I worked at transition projects for a little while. One blanket doesn't do it. One blanket they take out into the world, and for one reason or another, it gets left out in the rain, and they need another. There's also a use for things that are helping people set up a household who don't have a lot of money and who need stuff. So there's a lot of different needs. You could talk to Michael if you need to know more about it. We have a new care committee, and the care committee is designed to maybe express our love to one another in this community. So often what happens is someone will disappear for a while and we find out that they've been sick or that they've had some really significant problems in their life. And there are a lot of us who want to help. And so the care committee is designed to, with some discretion, provide services for those who need it. So you don't have to stand up here and tell everyone you need help. You could speak to me or Kathy Salvaggio, and we can connect you to the care committee. So this is an opportunity to open and receive and to help others as well. So Kathy Salvaggio is the best contact, but if she's not around, please talk with me and I'll be glad to help. We have hospitality every week through those doors. Don't wait after the Dharma talk today. Come and talk to people who have been doing this for a while and get to know each other. PIMC is a community that believes strongly that you don't take this path by yourself. It's very, very hard to sit and meditate every morning by yourself. So you can get support. You can find friends who are doing the same thing you are, and it's wonderful. We are currently interviewing for a children's program teacher. If you know of anyone who has experience and who might help us, it is a paid position. Doesn't pay a lot, but it is paid. And it's once a week, and you get to love our beautiful children. Every week after the Dharma talk, we do Dharma consults, and one of the teachers in training are in that little room. There's a sign-up list at the back of the room. So please, if you have questions about your practice or just want to find out more about PIMC, there will be one of us there. I will be doing the Dharma consults today, so come and talk to me. Speaking of which, I am here at 7:30 every Wednesday morning, early to meditate for 45 minutes and talk if you want me to. I am often alone. Get up early. Come keep me company. It's nice. I think that's it, except for the fact that we have that lovely brown box at the back of the room that will accept the expression of your love today to share with other people. And one of the things that we do with that is we make it possible for people to attend classes. Of course, we keep the building running. You can also go online to donate one time or to join our wonderful stewardship circle and join the community of people who are giving regularly so that we can predict how much money we have. Thank you very much, Robert. Are you ready for this? Are you ready? I think all our fire sticks are getting pretty bad.
Would you pass these out? Out. Sounds rather Canadian, doesn't it? That way. Just pass them back, I guess. Oh, I need one.
Yeah.
You may. Thank you. Well, here I am. I'm nervous. It's like, will I get in trouble? Will I make a fool of myself? Oh, good. There's more candles below. Joy. The central factor of the seven enlightenment factors is joy, bliss, delight. It's not by accident that spiritual communities all around the world sing together. And we don't have that so much. Certainly in the Theravadan Buddhist world, we don't. A long time ago, I worked as a ski patrolman in Switzerland on a big mountain. called the Gemstock. The whole mountain was above tree line. And the Swiss ski instructors meeting was at that mountain that year. And so there were 300, 400 Swiss who spoke four languages, French, German, Italian, and Romanche. And it was a remarkable experience to be there because they all knew all the songs. And on the cable car, there'd be 40 people in the cable car, they'd be singing a song together in three or four parts. And that's traditional cultures have that. And there's chanting in the Theravadan world. But this is a song that I really love, and I started playing the guitar 3 years ago or so with this very purpose in mind, and I'm just at the cusp where it's doable. And so I want you to join in as you can. The time sequence doesn't stay quite accurate. It varies a little bit. But I invite you to join me as you can. This is a Kate Wolf song, In Honor of Love. Kind friends all gathered round, there's something I would say. What brings us together here has blessed us all today. Love has made a circle that holds us all inside, where strangers are as family and loneliness can't hide. You must give yourself to love. If love is what you are after, open up your heart to the tears and the laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. I've walked these mountains in the rain. I've learned to love the wind. I've been up before the sunrise to watch the day begin. I always knew that I'd find you, though I never did know how. Like sunshine on a cloudy day, you stand before me now. So give yourself to love. If love is what you are after, open up your heart to the tears and the laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Love is born in fire, but it's planted like a seed. Love can't give you everything, but it'll give you what you need. Love comes when you are ready. Love comes when you're afraid. It will be your greatest teacher, the best friend you've ever made. So give yourself to love. If love is what you are after, open up your heart to the tears and the laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. Once more on the chorus, if I can find it. Give yourself to love. If love is what you are after, open up your heart to the tears and the laughter and give yourself to love. Give yourself to love. That worked. Yay. Weeha, Lord Buddha. All right. Give yourself to love. Hmm. It happens all the time in heaven. And someday it'll begin to happen again here on earth. That men and women who give each other light often will get down on their knees and with tears in their eyes will sincerely speak, saying, "My dear, how can I be more loving to you? How can I be more kind?" Hafiz. It happens all the time in heaven, and someday it will begin again to happen on earth. That people who give each other light often will get down on their knees and with tears in their eyes will sincerely speak, saying, "My dear, how can I be more loving to you? How can I be more kind?" Hafiz. Even after all this time, the sun never says to the earth, "You owe me." Look what happens with a love like that. It lights up the whole sky. Even after all this time, the sun never says to the earth, "You owe me." Look what happens with a love like that. It lights the whole sky. God, disguised as a myriad of things and playing a game of tag, has kissed you and said, "You're it." I really mean it. You're it. Now, it does not matter what you believe or feel, for something wonderful, major league wonderful, is going to happen. And, oh, here's a beauty again. Hafiz, my goodness. Admit something. Everyone you see, you say to them, "Love me." Of course, you don't say this out loud. Otherwise, someone would call the cops. Still, though, think about this. This great pull in us to connect. Why not become the one who lives with a full moon in each eye that is always saying with that sweet moon language what every other eye in this world is dying to hear? Admit something. Everyone you see, you say to them, "Love me." Of course, you do not do this out loud, otherwise someone would call the cops. Still, though, think about this. This great pull in us to connect, why not become the one who lives with a full moon in each eye that is always saying, with that sweet moon language, what every other eye in this world is dying to hear? So maybe that's... I thought there was one more. Oh, I'm so glad to see the candles being used. Ah, there it is. Some people who come here have been injured by religion. So I'm always a little cautious with the word God. God doesn't have to mean a male figure sitting on a cloud somewhere. It could mean the mystery or the utter unknown or the organizing principle of the universe or something. But this is called, "I knew we would be friends. As soon as you opened your mouth and I heard your soft sounds, I knew we would be friends. The first time, dear pilgrim, I heard you laugh, I knew it would not take me long to turn you back into God." As soon as you opened your mouth and I heard your soft sounds, I knew we would be friends. The first time, dear pilgrim, I heard you laugh, I knew it would not take me long to turn you back into God. So I think it helps with the framing of this to invoke Ram Dass, the wonderful teacher, 10 or so, 15 years older than me. Very important in bringing Dharma practice to the West. He had a saying, that he used to like to have us look around the room and say, isn't it wonderful to see all the forms of God in drag? Right, posing as this person and that person. And if we just have eyes to see, we're seeing the one, we're seeing the mystery. And in my observation, that's what falling in love is really about. It's about meeting at that place where separation and distance melts away. And of course, given the complexities of the human mind, we fall in love, and then of course we fall out of love, and then we learn to love each other if we're in a committed long-term relationship. I'm remembering a conversation with a couple in India, almost 40 years ago. I was then newly married, and this couple, they commented, they said, I don't understand, you in the West, you're into this love marriage thing. And they were pretty sophisticated young people. They said, you fall in love, and then you get married, and then you fall out of love, and then if you work at it, you learn to love each other. We just start there. Quite interesting. They said also, my sisters and brothers know more about me. They can do a better job of choosing than me. So who knows? I don't know. It took me several tries to get it right, so. So, my friends. How exquisite to be here with you today. Oh, I have an announcement. It's also exquisite. Sitting here next week at this time will be 7 of the 9 next generation teachers for their, quote, graduation ceremony. So I invite you to come to that extravaganza, and we'll have a nice time together. I've had the privilege of being in the teacher role with 9 people. There's 2 from British Columbia that aren't going to be able to make it. And they won't be teaching here at PIMC, except maybe very rarely. But the group, I approached it with great trepidation, because I thought, what could I possibly have to teach people for 3 years? And it turned out that there was a ton. In fact, there's tons more. And being in that role pulled out this 40 years of experience, very enriching. And also the group became the most intimate and trusting group I've ever been in. And we really love each other, and respect and support. And I got to do some of the deepest healing work I've ever experienced. It was about a year ago, a year and a month ago. Anyway, about a year ago. Ruth Dennison had died, and her memorial service hadn't happened yet. And I'd been very responsible, holding the community together down there, and also tending to Ruth during her dying. And the second to last morning, I woke up with this sense of grief, and I had an image of taking my mattress down to the living room and, here's the sadness, and asking everyone to gather around me, one person at my head, one at my feet, and everyone else to have a hand on me. And they, of course, acceded to that, and all hell broke loose. The grief was just, and there they were, this group of people. We've been together for, in our case, Jim and I, 20 years. With Doug, it's more than 30 years. And it was such a remarkable opportunity for healing. And what we realized was, if any of us need to be really supported, we're there for each other. So it was and is a practice of love. And that reminds me of this. I wanted to read this poetry. This teaching that I like to introduce as a teaching from a 20th century saint, Mr. Rogers. A friend of mine visited a beautiful monastery where a dozen monks, most of whom were in their 70s and 80s, were living. This is a place where once 60 to 70 men spent their lives studying and following a rule of very strict living, praying together 7 times a day, 7 days a week. They worked hard and were successful. My friend asked one of the monks why he felt that over the years the community had dwindled from 60 to 12. His reply was, "We did everything right. And somewhere in all that successful praying and work and living, we lost the most important thing of all, the thing that was so contagious and attracted people to us. We lost the naked love. Little by little, the success replaced love. Oh, sure, you can have love and success, but the love has to remain first, always first. Natural, affirming, inclusive, naked love. Love and success, always in that order. It's that simple, and it's that difficult." That's been, since the start, something that I read every time I think about the mission of PIMC. It's to actually be together in the soup. To actually develop caring relatedness. So we have caring relatedness externally with friendships, Kalyanamita, spiritual friendship. We also have it and can have it and need it desperately internally. How to befriend all parts of ourselves. I started today talking about stopping the war. I know for a long time in my practice, I really didn't understand. I didn't understand that the task wasn't to expunge, for instance, my needy inner child structure. It was to learn how to take care of that part of myself. To learn that, quote, little Bobby, not that there's a little Bobby, you know, but there's this part that is so easily feels abandoned and lonely and frightened and hopeless and despairing. And I learned very painfully, it isn't the job of anyone else, including my partners, it isn't the job of anyone else to fix that. It's my job. Others can help. Others can love us even when we're feeling unlovable. But ultimately, it really does come down to making room for everything. And so when desperation or hopelessness or depression or anxiety or whatever those states are, when they emerge, rather than pushing them away, the task is take them on our laps, sit down, embrace them. And notice we get blown away and we get identified with it and we're gone for an hour. And then we realize, oh, this is a state. There are these powerful trance states that we get caught in. Some of them are characterological. We learned them in childhood. They were very strongly reinforced. But I'm utterly convinced that with the tools at our disposal, which particularly the Dharma, in my case, psychotherapy has been incredibly useful, deep loving relationship, in loving relationships as well, that if we undertake the task, we really can come to love ourselves. I've seen it time and again. Self-hatred is an artifact of our culture. It doesn't exist in some cultures. It doesn't exist among the Tibetans or the Thais. Imagine that. The Dalai Lama had difficulty understanding the Western teachers when they were talking about that. He said, you mean that some of your students have spontaneously arising thoughts of self-hatred and disliking? And he said, have any of you ever experienced this? So it's part of how we raise children. It's part of the... And fortunately, it's just programming. Right? It's not something that you do to yourself. It's something that the conditioned mind does. And it's quite possible, living proof, it's quite possible to become so aware of it and so accepting somehow that it actually gets less and less and less and less and less and less and less. And it doesn't take forever. Of course, it's frightening. We turn toward that sadness that we have the sense that if I ever felt this sadness fully, I'd cry for the rest of my life or forever. Or if I ever allowed this rage to come to consciousness, I'd destroy the world, which is the experience of the two-year-old, right? It's really a good thing that two-year-olds are so small. Because that rage, the psychiatric world calls it talionic rage. It's the rage that would destroy the parent. And they would. You, if you've been around a two-year-old and they're really angry, it's like, whoa. But fortunately, they can be contained and loved, and then that passes. And it's very important that they don't win at that age. That creates monsters. So... I'm not going to ask you to share this out loud, but what is there in yourself that you hate? What is there in yourself that you'd really wish would just stop? What is there in others that you feel very judgmental of? And what is there in the world that you can't stand or that you feel? Yeah, you feel hatred towards things like war, poverty. What if we took as a task to allow there to be room for everything, including our disliking or our hatred. Allowing there to be room for everything doesn't mean that we don't work to change the outer circumstance or the inner circumstance, actually. What it means is that we actually allow ourselves to experience it as it is. For instance, think of my... I've had so much work to do befriending anger and befriending desperate, codependent loneliness. What I've had to do is say yes to it. Yep, that exists. It exists, and something else exists increasingly, which is the Buddha. Awareness is bigger than everything. that batik over there, that little green or big green batik, I purchased in India just after my first meditation course in 1971. There's all the formations of life, and in the back there's this mysterious, miraculous awareness. And it's right here. Become aware of the contact of your body with the cushion. That's awareness. It'll never get any more pure or profound than that. Become aware of the mood that's present. So there's a mood and there's awareness. The only difference between us and a Buddha is that that awareness is always on in a Buddha. Always present. It's a big thing to say, but I believe it to be true. So part of the work is developing a practice where we can park and watch the show. Increasingly realizing everything is a show in consciousness. And we cultivate what the Buddha called the Brahma Viharas, the abode of the gods. In a certain way, we cultivate them. In another way, it's like pruning and what's left. There's love, compassion, sympathetic joy, and equanimity. And in love, there's room for everything. And if we were to put it in a simple phrase, it might be, may I be happy? May I feel really secure and safe? When love, a mind with love encounters suffering, it converts to compassion. Oh, pain is happening. How can I help? The sensitive heart's natural trembling when faced with pain, with suffering, is compassion. When the sensitive heart, the open heart, encounters success and happiness, it turns into sympathetic delight. And so we wind up, someone's having great success, and we get a contact high. It's like, yes, they're succeeding. And then there's the fourth, which is little understood, little taught even, which is equanimity, which is the capacity to accept things really as they are. Right? There are psychopathic killers in the world. Some of them are in positions of great power. It's true. It's always been true. It'll always be true. That's the way of the world. Lots of people die unfairly. That's true. Doesn't mean we don't work to make things fair, but there's a way that we can face deeply into the suffering of the world if we can also accept, yep, that's how it is, and I don't have to suffer. I don't have to go. So a common thing I work with people, as their meditation deepens, they get more and more uptight and anxious and can't stand things. But and that's a contracting down. What one has to do is open and realize, ah, yes. This is the universe manifesting as this suffering and this suffering and this suffering. And so we then do our little bit that we can. So, I'd like you to sit comfortably, and I'm going to do a very simple reminder practice. I've gathered over the years many phrases. These phrases are intended to provoke and support these abode of the gods practices. And please let your auto translator be on and translate any of these instantly into different words. Whatever would really make sense for you. May I be really happy. Well, there's one more piece I want to say before I start. Normally one starts with oneself and then move to a benefactor, and the benefactor, someone who, someone who it's really easy to love, who's been very kind to us. then a neutral person, then friends, and then someone with whom you've had conflict, and then out and out and out until one is wishing well to all beings. For lots of Westerners, we can't start with the self because we have too much self-hatred, in which case then start with someone that's really easy to love. Or a dog or a cat or some place where you've experienced love. You can remind yourself, I sometimes remind myself of instances with my children when they were little and that huge space of love opened up between us. My daughter and I lying on the waterbed with both of us with fevers and our heads touching and whew, that sense of love. I can remember that. But we're just going to do the I in this one. So, may I be happy. Wish that for yourself. Imagine that. May I be free from fear and danger. May I live with ease and grace. May I remember my great nature. May I be liberated. May I be free from all forms of danger and harm from within and without. May I experience mental happiness and physical happiness and health. May I have ease of well-being. May I live with ease and grace. May I be liberated. Any resistance you run into, love that too. I aspire to love and accept myself exactly as I am in this moment. Whenever I'm hurting, no matter how I'm hurting, I aspire to hold myself in sweet compassion. I aspire to learn to trust the world. May I meet the suffering and ignorance of others with compassion. May I know the complete safety of an undefended heart. May I realize that joy is possible in this very moment. May my entire life become one great sigh of gratitude. May I know happiness and the causes of happiness. May I know the end of suffering and the roots of suffering. May I never be separated from the great equanimity free of suffering. May I always dwell in the great understanding free from passion, aggression, and discrimination. And so these are words. Perhaps useful words. Another way to approach it is to think of some time when you were really experiencing love. With a person, with an animal, with an outdoor somehow. When your heart was really open. Just remember that. Every single one of us in this room knows, has tasted extraordinarily open-heartedness. It may have been covered over We may have reacted to that vulnerability with fear, because sometimes it happens with another person and then they disappear. But it's possible to remember. To remember it as a feeling or a story. Opening your heart to yourself. There's all kinds of ways to do this. You could imagine a golden Buddha sitting in your heart, shaped exactly like you, exactly every pore the same as you. And imagine that love flows from this archetypal figure inside you, to your body, to the places where you're psychologically and emotionally wounded and contracted. To the stories that you have about how you've been wronged, or about how you've hurt somebody else, how there's something wrong with you. Light it up. Let it light up with love. And then a next step might be to let that golden being that you're imagining, and some people can't imagine stuff like this, in which case it's just an energy or a thought. Imagine that golden being expanding until her body or his body exactly is contiguous with yours. And so your very body becomes a transmitter out into this room to everyone here. What would be your deepest wish for everyone here? May you be happy. May you remember your freedom. Whatever it would be you for you, imagine that you're radiating that out into the room. And we're going to do a very, very beautiful practice now. From here, it'll go like this. And, well, I'm going to start some music, let it play for a couple of minutes. And then I'll get up and I'll help a couple of people up. And those people help some more people up, two more. Before long, we'll all be up. And then once you're up, I'd like you to come and take a rose. Take a rose, and then to meet others, all the while remembering your wish that you're wishing for all beings or for everyone in the room, to meet them and bow to one another holding your rose, and then exchange roses. And then go on to another person, make eye contact, bow, hand. You don't have to do this. It may be that this is too much in some way, in which case, when someone comes to help you up, let them help you up and then just come and sit, okay, get a rose maybe, come and get a rose, and then sit on the pews at the side. We're practicing spiritual liberty, not spiritual tyranny. And so for some people, sometimes this kind of practice is just too invasive, in which case it's fine. That's complete participation to be respectful of your boundaries. So then we'll bow to one another. We'll do that for a little while, and then we'll stop. And we get to keep the roses, take them home. The music, I've been playing this for 20 years. The music is from the Sufis. The words mean God is love, the lover, and the beloved. Most tragically, in our time, there is a madness emerging about Islam. And this is the heart of the practice. This is the heart of Islam. God is love, the lover, and the beloved. And Muhammad is his prophet. Ishq Allah ma'bud layla. La ilaha el Allahu. There's nothing that's not God. It's all one. It's not about God, someone sitting out there. That's really childhood religion, right? To know what we know about the universe, there's not someone sitting out there. But is there extraordinary love possible in our lives? And is there something utterly mysterious happening that we don't have the least idea? Absolutely. Remember, holding that wish, that blessing, radiating out into the room. And if there's a part of you that says, this is silly, love that part. If there's a part of you that says, oh, I can't do this, I'm not loving enough, love that part. Actually, let's change the procedure. When I help you up, come and get two roses and help people up and you give them the roses. Help two people up. Two. Actually, I'm going to do a couple more. Go grab two more. Two people. Two and two. Remember, you are radiators of infinite love. And then find someone to bow to with, oh, but I guess everybody's up. Good, good. Yes, your face is familiar. Thank you. test one. That chant is one of the central practices in Sufism. You can imagine, I've done it in a room with 200 people and a sheikh from Turkey, wild man, boy. He had us in 16 groups and we were all doing a different part of the chant, and he'd come around and jazz us up. And there's a movement, the body's moving, you know, locked arms, and the head is moving like this. And there's a visualization, which is that there's a cone of light that goes all the way up into the infinite vastness of the universe. And that one is reaching up into that Allah, which is the one, and then who is the manifesting of the love of God, of the love of the universe in the heart. So we're reaching up into the brilliant spiral, and then who into the heart. Quite a nice practice. And one does that maybe for an hour or an hour and a half, and there's transcending of separateness. It's a powerful, very powerful, beautiful practice. So, it's a room full of beautiful children. How do you like that? I do. Please, let's form a big circle. And anyone who'd like to join us in the Sanctum Sanctorum in the middle, please do. You can come join us. Yes. Hello, young man. You can recognize me by my rose. May I hold your hand? Oh, and hold your hand too. Hang on. There we go. Not only is it Valentine's Day, but it's Faye's birthday. And of course, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Faye. Happy birthday to you. So, love, there's room for everything. Give a squeeze of the hand on your left and think a kind thought. You may know or not know the person beside you, but you know the one thing they certainly need is to be loved. As they are. Same with the one on the right. Give that hand a little squeeze. It's remarkable that we have access to something so exquisitely important and so simple. It's like awareness. It's right there. And so extending this around our circle to everyone here, to all of our friends and relatives, and to those we think of as them, as the enemy, as the other. In fact, to all beings, our brothers and sisters of the air, the earth, and the waters. We're all living on this little dust speck. It's 8,000 miles thick. That's all. In the midst of the infinite vastness of space. So, why not love each other, starting with ourselves? Oh, I need the microphone, please, Kate. You have two singers?
Three. Are you
three? All right. Are you all together? I only see two. Oh. All right. You want to all get a hand on the microphone? Here. Ready? Come close. You have four singers. This dog is singing too. Okay. When you're ready, go.
May
all
beings be happy.
May all beings be happy. May all beings be happy. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Thank you. That was very important. All right, and now. And now we practice patience until I count. Are you ready? Everyone in the room gets to take in a nice deep breath. One, two, three, blow. Yay, we did it. Well, thank you, dear friends. Please take your rose with you.
And come and join us for some coffee, tea, and treats.
You get one, sure. All the kids get one. You get one.
Thank you.
Yay, my pleasure.